It's begun. Yep, it's begun. Invite your cousin who's your age over for to do a podcast and all your secrets come out.
Okay, Joey, so this is a question from Chad who couldn't be with us today, but he wanted to know, what's the most petty thing Ricky did as a child regarding cards?
Oh, God, most petty thing. I don't know if he ever... I think he probably traded me way too many Vin Bakers. And selling me on the idea that he's going to be the next Karl Malone, because I have a collection of Vin Bakers that it's way too extensive.
And Luke Longley.
Hey, Luke Longley.
And Tony Kukoc.
I got about 200 Lindsey Hunters, if you guys remember that.
Oh, man.
You don't have
no reason to have a Lindsey Hunter card.
No. That, just no.
Ricky probably hustled me, but I won in the end with my Michael Jordan collection.
Yes, you did.
There's an Adam. Oh, it's a 101.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of Pack to the Future. I'm your host, Ricky, a.k.a. Mr. eBay. And I am joined by my guest host and partner in crime, my cousin, Joey.
And you never walk away from the table when you're on a heater.
And we're joined, as always, by the great... He's slicing and dicing again, ladies and gentlemen. Dr. Tim.
Here we go, baby. Prepare to be underwhelmed.
All right. For this week's show, as you can tell, Chad's out of town, camping with Papa Doc. And so Timmy and I are holding down the fort. I threw it out to my cousin, Joey, and we welcome here on the show today. Welcome.
Thanks for having me. I got a quick question though. Who has their finger on the sensor button?
Oh, no, we don't have a sensor button officially.
So often.
Yeah. So we
give you a warning or like a what?
Yeah. So nope. we switch. It's a rotation of who has to edit the show each week. And I have gone above and beyond and been an excellent friend for Chad and agreed to cover his editing duties this week, which is a big favor to the two of you, because when he is editing, you cannot swear. But when I'm editing, swear away, baby. We'll fix it in post. But we thought it would be fun. So I reached out to Joey immediately, because Joey was my first Tim and Chad. It was my brother, my younger brother, a year younger than I was, Joey and myself. And we were growing up as just little kiddies running up and down our backyard court, playing, shooting hoops and going to the card shop. And so I think he had some pretty interesting perspectives. As if I have it down correctly, Joey, when we both stepped away probably from the hobby, I'd say about end of elementary, maybe junior high. And you have not been back, really. Is that correct?
No, I've tried to get my son involved. And through that, I kind of had a little nostalgic kick. And I got some packs for myself and didn't get the same blood flowing that it once did. But I tried to get him involved. But, yeah, I pretty much just quit cold turkey. Like, you can see, like, the years of all my last cards are all, like, the same year.
Well, what year do you think that was? For me, I think it was probably... I'd say junior high, somewhere in the junior high period, probably for us.
Yeah. I mean, 96, 97, I'll just pull my cards out to find out.
Yeah. And that's kind of my recollection. And so in a minute, I had some cards delivered and we'll dive into those. Because I want to get your perspective on them. But before we do that, I wanted to talk about some of the experiences Joey and I had growing up together in this hobby. And Joey, my local card shop growing up was always the one near Over the Counter Cafe. And those that are not local, which is most of our audience, will not know where any of these are. Is that the main one that you would consider yours as well?
Oh, yeah, because your mom would always buy me packs.
Tim,
what a cool mom.
This card shop was located kitty corner to a Pizza Hut and Blockbuster Video.
What more could you ask for?
At 10 to 12 years old, it was the Holy Trinity, I'm telling you. And back then, Pizza Hut wasn't lame like it is now. Back then, you used to get like basketballs. Remember, they'd give you like full-size basketballs with your pizza order and like movies to watch. So we used to always hit up those three. I know that my dad is Joey's mom's older brother. And I got to tell you, my recollection is that before we could get to the card shop, we had to get started on a hangout and a sleepover. And the sleepovers didn't always work out. Joey's mom wasn't always willing to let Joey sleep over. And so there were times that my dad probably legally kidnapped his nephew by telling his mother that, well, this, you know where he'll be. I'm not bringing him to you at 11 o'clock at night.
She hated that response.
Oh, yeah. And like, oh, and we were terrified. I think there's probably once or twice that she probably came to get you.
Oh, yeah.
And I was worried for your physical safety. Not because she was angry with you, but just because I knew my dad had worked her up so much. Uh-huh. But we used to do those and get going over doing trades over our sleepovers. And for me, I always remember that, like, we couldn't get in the car to go to each other's house. Like, I don't think we'd let each other get in the car if we didn't bring our binder. For trading, because like that was what we did, and it didn't matter if we had just seen each other had a like a two night sleepover two nights ago. It was still bring your binder. There's more deals to be done.
It was the original like insider trading kind of like hustle, like you're like a little hustler when you're trading cards. Yes.
Oh, that was serious stuff back then. I mean, you don't mess around with the binders. I mean,
no, yeah. No,
and somebody had to have a Beckett.
Yes, a Beckett. You always had to have a Beckett so that you could figure out the values of the cards you were trading and make sure you were under your salary caps. do you remember what the routine was for New Year's Eve? Because we used to spend a couple of those together too.
Yeah, we always played.
My mom's so crazy.
A different board game, and your mom would buy, I don't know, 100 packs.
Mm-hmm.
And whoever won the game got to pick which pack we'd open next. And so we'd all just be like,
oh, nice.
You want to pick it. And it went on forever. And then the most like disappointing time was like the last game was over and we turned to her and be like, all right, we're ready for the pack. And she'd just be like,
that's it.
You're out.
That was it. And then our sugar rush reaches like an all-time low. We get hungry and violent.
Yeah. 12 cans of Mountain Dew later, you're still just.
Yes.
But I wanted to share that moment because I think that might be a fun way for, we have a lot of listeners that have kids that have gotten into the hobby. And I think that's an awesome way to maybe like bring it back. When you go get those Target packs now, make it an event, a game night or something. Cause that was a ton of fun. We'd play NBA Monopoly, NBAopoly.
Nice.
That game was dope. I wish they still had that game. Yes. I'm sure they have some version of it, but I remember that game being so fun.
Yeah, yeah. So what I thought might be a good idea is I sent you over earlier today, Joey, a box of cards that comprise a chunk of my personal collection.
You know which one's going to be missing when you get it back?
Oh, man. If it's the one I think, you know what? I might be okay with it if you want to steal it. I might let you. Does it have a number 8 on it? Is it in a container that you cannot open?
Oh, well, no, I do like that card because I have about a dozen of them. So I saw the price on it. I was like, okay.
Let's see it.
You talking about this one?
Yeah.
Nice. Yeah. Yeah.
I have plenty of those.
Yeah. So hold on to those. So
Michael Jordan, I'll just tell you the Michael Jordan retirement one.
Oh, yeah. That's so funny that you say that because we're going to get into that in just a minute and more.
So he's had a cool mom. You know what I mean? Like everybody else's mom during this era was actively throwing people's cards away.
She was
instead of like feeding you guys packs.
No, she was a ton of fun for the three of us. I don't know that she did us, my brother and I, a lot of favors growing up. But she spoiled us. She absolutely spoiled us. And Joey got in on that for sure. Cause he really was like the third brother. We were together that often. And so, but I sent over this box of cards. This is a chunk of my personal collection because I want to get some of your thoughts on what this box represents is the ways in which the hobby has changed since we've walked away. And so I'm going to have you take out that first stack first, and you don't have to take them out as we go, or if you remember, whatever. But I'll just kind of go over on the air what I sent over. In the first stack are my slabs. Examples of slabs. The top card is my HGA hybrid grading approach. Barry Sanders rookie card. That is the card that Joshua bought me for Valentine's Day when we were about 9 years old.
That's cool.
Yeah. Some of the characteristics of HGA are you get to choose the splash color of the paint to match the jersey or card color. You'll also notice that it gives you an overall grade of the card and subgrades. This isn't the new thing that's been happening since we've walked away, Joey, where they are now grading and putting them in these slabs that cannot be reopened without damaging the slab permanently.
There's ways around that, but yeah.
Sure. In theory, that's what this is meant to be done. Okay.
Yeah.
Then I also included in the box 5 BGS slabs, the Dak Prescott 2018 Prism Rookie Auto. Now that card was the one that he got in trouble for using the autograph machine for signing. And it made headlines on SportsCenter. And there's a sticker on the back that shows that this was actually observed to have him sign it. We've got a Donovan Mitchell rookie card from Hoops. We've got a Ken Griffey Jr. Upper Deck Gowdy from 2007 with the Reds. I need like that. I threw that in there for you. Jose Altuve 2017 Allen and Ginter framed mini. Now that is representative of Allen and Ginter does the tobacco cards. They include one of those mini cards in each of their packs. And then you've got the 2012 Allen and Ginter stained glass rip mini. And we're going to get into, you saw the rip card as well that we'll dive into in a minute, Joey. But that stained glass card can only be obtained from those rip cards. We also have 5 PSA slabs, the Jordan 90 Skybox. We've got the Shohei Ohtani, his rookie triple threads.
Better not sell that.
No, I think I'm going to hold on to that or list it at an absurd price.
This stuff's skyrocketing. It's nuts.
Yeah.
700% up this year.
Yeah. Joey, that price you see on that card was actually, it sold for something similar to that recently. We've got a Miguel Cabrera, Gypsy Queen autograph, Donovan Mitchell mosaic montage, which is what I meant to bring to your house, Timmy, last week and didn't.
No, I saw that picture.
And then we've got the Michael Jordan Metal Universe Championship. That Metal Universe is actually from my collection from when we were kids, Joey. I found that from my binder.
Yep. That was in his binder. I was like, dude, Ricky, you got to send that in. Of course, PSA took so long that they severely undergraded it now. So
now that you've seen some BGS slabs, I'll tell you some of their characteristics are you're going to see as well the overall grade with subgrades. That's what people like. You'll notice that the labels will be paper for an 8 or lower. They will be silver 8.5 or higher. They will be gold 9.5 or higher. BGS is Beckett. That's the same company that released the magazine that we loved when we were growing up. And they were the first ones really to come out with this service in my mind. They also offer the elusive. If you get a 10, a graded score of a 10 overall, and every subscore is a 10, you get a black label, which is like a Bentley. It could be a Kurt Rambis black label, and you're going to get some good money.
Easy there.
Finally, with the PSA slabs, you'll notice that they have the more routine labels. They do not offer the subgrades. They might be a little bit lighter, a little less clunky. And they have really seen they've really come along in the pandemic. I mean, they've been around for throughout, but they've really surged, I feel, during the pandemic. So, Joey, seeing all those, what are your thoughts on this idea of, one, slabbing cards, and two, if you were to, does it interest you, and which company?
Well, can they come out of this plastic little wrapper as well?
Yeah. Yeah. That's just to protect them from getting scratched. So just don't rub them together.
Or on your balls.
The whole time.
Oh, you can rub them together as long as the plastic's on. That's fine.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Uh-huh.
They have stayed off camera this whole time.
I know.
I don't know what he's doing with them.
They might have gone down his pants.
Just the Jordans. Just the Jordans. I think they're pretty cool. I mean, the cementing them in seems kind of, intense. It's like permanent.
Yeah.
Like if you ever want to do anything else different with it, it just seems you're stuck with that option, right?
Right.
They all seem pretty cool.
Does one company seem more reputable, one slab than the others? Any thoughts on those?
I kind of like the thickness. The Beckett one's a little thicker than the other ones.
Yeah, there we go.
And like I mentioned, I'm a Beckett guy.
You are. I tried to. See? I had to give you that fact that was Beckett, and I knew once I did, that's probably where you were going. By the way, for those of you at home, who's your favorite football player of all time?
Tom Brady.
Okay, and who's your favorite basketball player of all time?
I got great taste. Michael Jordan.
And who's your favorite baseball player of all time?
Ken Griffey.
Okay. So of course he chooses BGS. That's your guy, Tim.
I got a fine palate.
No, those are pretty solid choices.
Hey, before you like Tom Brady, who was your favorite quarterback?
Drew Bledsoe.
Okay, fine. Yeah. Right before that, okay. Who was it?
Right before that. Hey, growing up as a Mormon in Utah, you had to follow Steve Young. Before that, Joe Montana.
Right. He is
not McMahon.
McMahon. Don't say I'm fair weather. I can actually prove that I'm not fair weather based on my cards.
Oh, really?
Go back in my old card collection. In the last like 4 years I was collecting, I had a Drew Bledsoe collection, Curtis Martin, Terry Glenn, Fred Byers, Ben Coates, Sean Jefferson.
I had
20 of these at least. I had a whole book of just Patriots guys. Not one Tom Brady card. I have not one Tom Brady card.
Nice.
Oh, that had to have killed you though to like find that and get so excited and then to say like, no, not one Brady.
Nope, I didn't make it to the Brady era. You threw in the towel like at probably one of the worst times in the hobby. Like you had just made it through the junk wax era, right? And you were just about to dip your toes into like the era of cards to like start in.
Yeah, I think I stopped collecting pretty much when Jordan retired for the second time.
Yeah, I can see that. Yeah.
That's fair. Yeah. Well, especially since you were following him. So yeah.
Yeah, and I only collected Jordan by that point.
Oh, and he would just take. I can't even like that was. I got so many questions about that. So many Jordans. Every good Jordan I had, he has. Like, I think I even ranted to you, Tim. Like when you came over, that's probably like 10% of what I had. And do you remember who my player personal collection was in basketball?
Basketball. Was it Barkley?
No, you're giving me way too much credit. It was a Malone.
Jeff Malone. In the
So I'm sure I got like, plenty.
Who holds on to the Jeff Malone card?
So he got like all my Jordans for all these awful Jeff Malone, David Robinson, just terrible. All right, so let's dive back into the box I sent you, the time capsule, if you will. The next stack over are a stack of in magnetic cases. What do you think of these new magnetic cases to begin with? These didn't exist when we walked away.
I think they look sleeker than the other cases.
Better than the screwdrivers, right? The screws.
I like.
Oh, yeah. Painful.
These ones with the gold.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Yeah, I like these ones. I don't know why.
They're much better than the or either had the screw on or the plastic snap. And they just like you could just tell it was damaging the card if you didn't have it in there perfectly. Okay, so in that second stack, we've got Staff Sergeant Tom Rice is the first card from Upper Deck's Goodwin Champions Museum Collection insert set.
I want to ask you about that card. I forget where I put it.
No, you're just fine.
I've lost half your deck already, but
you're okay.
It looks like the autograph, his autograph, I don't know if he's passed away by now, but it looks like you probably went to his viewing and held the pen in his hand for him.
Don't put it beyond Ricky.
I don't even know if it's spelled correctly, but you can see a T and an R. It looks like a first grader.
Well, first of all, he was probably on his deathbed. How dare you? That was going to be my question for you, though. I have a couple of questions about these cards in these stacks. And one of them is, does that hold any value to you, that card? If you read about, did you read the back of the card? He was a World War II vet. He jumped out of planes. He wasn't messing around. Does that hold any value for you as a collector? Should you come back, or would it hold it for you as a kid collector?
No. Not as a card. Like if I could have memorabilia, like, I don't know, part of the barrel of his gun or something like that, or like part of his uniform.
Okay.
I think that's something. If you were to sign something like that, that would be cool. But a card, I don't know.
Okay. I mean, I wanted your unique perspective on this. I think that's a legitimate perspective. I don't have that good a handwriting. Hasn't that been
done? You know, the like a shaving or like a ring off the barrel of a gun? Like, why doesn't that kind of relic exist?
God.
Or like a shaving off the stock of a rifle? Like, forget these patches off a uniform. I mean.
Yeah, yeah.
That would be cool.
Yeah.
Tim and I were talking earlier about the Frank Thomas baseball bat he's got signed behind him. Imagine if he had like his full like a bayonet or some shit behind him that said... signature on it or something.
Wow. One of
That'd
one.
Be intense.
Mark, one of one. One.
That'd be intense. Yeah.
Add his stats is like his kill count.
Yeah. Engraved on like a discarded casing. Yeah. That'd be cool.
All right. So included also in that stack is the Kurt Rambis 2019.
Oh,
out of three.
You I figured had to do it.
Yeah, I had to do it.
I respect it.
Thank you. We've got a Derek Jeter 2019 Allen and Ginter framed mini relic. That is an actual piece of his jersey. And you get two of those hits per box with Allen and Ginter.
I have a question about the jersey cards.
Yeah.
First of all, it says game used. So it doesn't say game worn. Is there
game used is game worn. Well, you know what? That's a good question. But what else would it be if it's a pinstripe?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know, warm-ups. I don't know. I don't think it's anything.
It might be an out. It might be an out for some sort of warm-up.
That's a good point, you know? Like, yeah, game used. It could have been, like, his backup jersey hanging in his locker, right? Mm-hmm. Like, it might not have been worn. That's a good point.
Yeah, and I wish that the jersey matched the jersey they're wearing on the car.
Just a crime, right? You know, it's like, why put that patch in there on a card that has them in the wrong uni?
And Joey, I'll tell you, they go far more offensive than that, where they will put like a LeBron James black and maroon Cavs piece of jersey, and then it's him in a Lakers uni.
Yeah. It's like, those are just so bad.
And they've actually gotten so bad, like that they'll take players that have gotten traded. There's like a Karl Malone city to city double patch. One's a Laker patch, one's a Jazz patch.
Yeah.
I'm going to send it to Chad just because it's so mean, so unnecessarily mean and hurtful. No, but you're onto something, Joey, in that those patches, they will often, they'll often mark on their stuff. Like, here's one I have. This is a Nico Mannion Christmas sweater that our listeners love giving me crap about getting. The fabric in there is a Christmas sweater, like the colors of the Warriors. But if you read the back, it says the enclosed officially licensed material is not associated with any specific player, game, or event.
It's a sweater.
It's just, they just cut up a colored sweater.
Like, why?
So you have to be very careful about what you see on those, because they will get you with, And there are photos, Joey, of like, okay, Joey and I did this. Remember when you and I, we put on every piece of sporting jerseys that we owned on you?
You owned about 75 pairs of jerseys.
I did.
Almost every single jersey from every single player.
Yes. And shorts. And many of the shorts. And
it was a little disturbing, to be honest.
It was. It's what I wore every day to school. But there was a point when Joey and I were like 10, 11, that we put on every jersey on top of him. And I think he ended up
wore all of them.
Yeah, I'm pretty certain he ended up urinating himself because we got to the end and he's like, I really have to go, guys. But
he did that on purpose. You know that.
Yeah. But that's what they do with these players. They have them put on 30 jerseys and just like they look like this, like this big Cartman character. And what they do is they cut up all those jerseys and say player worn. Uh-huh. So you got to watch out for game worn, game used, that kind of stuff.
Those have gotten so rare. That's the disappointing part. You know, as time has gone on in the modern hobby, like it's just the quality just keeps deteriorating. Yeah.
Yes, exactly. A couple other cards I included in there were a Kerryon Johnson, impeccable football. That was a rookie patch auto with his jersey, a jersey that he wore, probably like I just explained, and a piece of helmet. If I recall correctly.
Mm-hmm.
And then we also have a Ty Cobb 2020 historic autographs written word. Now, Joey, what this is a letter Ty Cobb wrote and they just cut up a couple pieces of words and you could get a piece of a letter that he had written. And now you could go online and type in the code on their website and they'll tell you which letter it is. They'll show you the complete letter. And if you're lucky enough to get the bottom, you would get his autograph, right? Because it would have his name. What are your thoughts on that?
I like the idea, especially if it was like a famous speech and you caught like a specific word in it, or if you had the dream and I have a dream or something. But yours says, which they.
Yep.
Yeah. You know the rest of the sentence?
No, because the problem is they actually have like 30 letters too. You know, for me, the reason that I picked that up is it was a very reasonably priced way to own something of Ty Cobb's. Knowing I'm never going to own an auto. I'm never going to own a rookie of his. And so I agree with you. I'm on the fence of whether that really is of anything of value. But I wanted to share that with you. We've also got the, Bill Walton 2017, Dominion main, exhibit legends. I thought you'd get a kick out of that card, a LeBron James absolute glass card and a Mike. Okay, go ahead.
I almost like tossed that to the side cause I couldn't see the LeBron in it.
Oh, really?
I held up to the line. I'm like, oh, shit, there's a player on there.
Yes.
I think LeBron's a coward, but I think the card's cool. Yeah.
Well, and I've got like a Steph Curry. I should have sent you the Steph Curry. And then we've got a Mike Trout Project 2020 card. Can you pick up that Project 2020 card?
Yeah, I got you.
Will you read the bottom left corner what that emblem says?
On the
bottom
back.
Bottom right. On the front, bottom right, that little circle.
California love with let's see.
Ben Baller.
Ben Baller did the card.
So
California love.
This is
California love with.
This is a project that Topps did last year where they collaborated with artists, including Ben Baller. That's his designed cards. They got to design, you know, 12 cards. But that ended up spinning off to a completely different set of Topps Ben Baller brand, which was highly sought after and in demand. My question for you, are cards art?
Isn't art in the eye of the beholder? It's kind of...
Yeah. But do you think that they are art and how we would... display art?
I don't know. That's a great question. I mean, I could see why you could appreciate it, and from that perspective, But to me, like, just a classic look of a card isn't, has no art, artistic ability or approach to it whatsoever.
Fair.
Has, holds more value to me. So I don't, I think it's just in the eye of the beholder at that point.
Yeah. All right. We're going to speed up with just a couple more. I'm just going to jump to a couple more quick cards that I put in there. On this third stack, we have an Anthony Rizzo Topps Archive signature buyback of his 2016 Allen and Ginter. It's marked as a one of one. You see that? Or did you lose that one? Here's my question. I'll pad for you while you're pulling it up. There it is. So that came out in 2016 as an Allen and Ginter. What year does it say for the Allen and Ginter? Yeah, 2016 for Allen and Ginter. And then they what happened is Allen, they bought that card back offline, and Topps did, and then had him sign it. They stamped it with the one of one because that's the only one they had him sign, and then re-released it. My question, is that a real one of one?
It's a labyrinth type question.
Well, it's a base card that they had him sign.
Yeah, I guess so. I think it's a really cool looking card.
Yeah. No, the Allen and Ginter.
I would consider this art.
You would consider. Okay. Okay.
Over the last card that we saw with the.
Over Ben Baller?
Yeah. Not a fan of Ben Baller.
Oh, them are fighting words.
Either, but.
No, that's great. The Hanley Ramirez 2016 Strata baseball relic. It had a sticker on it with an auto. Now, this is something that Top Strata did in all their products for a while. Strata went away, but Topps occasionally will still do this. That sticker, you can go onto MLB's website, type in that little code, and it will tell you which specific game that patch is from that he wore it in.
I think that is really cool.
Yeah.
I talked with Tim before if he knew where that bat came from.
Mm-hmm.
It's Frank Thomas bat and the specific game and how he hit with it. I think that idea is pretty cool that you can find out exactly what it is, especially if they had a great game.
Yeah, exactly. And like, and to know like, oh, this is that piece of blood from when Nolan Ryan beat the hell out of Robin Yount or whatever. Mm-hmm. What is his last name?
Robin Ventura.
I don't know why I said Yount.
One of those Robins.
Yeah. But like, no, and that is, I think that is such a cool thing, and I'm shocked that baseball or football and basketball doesn't do it.
Yeah.
All right. Well, after seeing all of this, and I'm going to skip over the rest because there wasn't too much interesting else in there. Oh, go ahead.
I found your creepy Nico Mannion collection. Okay. Got about 100 of these, bro.
Yeah. So that's the one thing.
Calm down. You're a grown man now.
That is the one thing.
He's calling you on it already, Ricky.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's like the new thing though, Joey, is that didn't exist in, that is commonplace in all sorts of cards. And what I sent that to you for is to show you that parallels are the new thing. And certain colors represent short prints. Certain colors will actually be numbered on the back. And the thing to do is to chase what they call rainbows from the one of one to the common card. And so I sent those to you specifically because we're going to cover those in our upcoming news story. We'll be back with that and more right after this.
Sunday.
Hi, this is Ricky from the Pack of the Future podcast. Be sure to join us Sunday, July 11th for Sports Card Nation's Hobby Palooza 2021. That's right, your three favorite podcast hosts are going to join John Newman live at 7 p.m. Eastern to entertain the hobby masses. So what are you waiting for? Go check out and bookmark sportscardnation.net, then join us on July 11th at 7 p.m. for all the frills and thrills your hobby heart desires. All right, everyone, welcome back to the show. You can always reach out to us by phone at 801-893-1609. Leave us a voicemail. You may make it to air and be part of the show. You can also reach out to us on our Instagram at Pack to the Future Podcast. Guys, for the second segment, I wanted to talk about, we haven't done news for a bit, and I thought it might be a good time to hold a new segment with Joey, given the fact that he hasn't been collecting in a bit. So bring him up to speed with the latest in the hobby.
It should be fun.
So the first piece of news, Upper Deck and Panini had evidently been engaged in a big old lawsuit because a couple of Michael Jordan images appeared on some of Panini's cards. Now, Joey, you may be interested to find out that Upper Deck no longer has the rights to basketball. Panini owns all NBA. They are the sole owner of the licensing. Upper Deck has hockey and hockey. And Michael Jordan and LeBron James. It's real interesting. So what happened was, Timmy, why don't you explain a little bit about this?
Yeah, so what Ricky's hinting at is that, you know, these companies have their exclusive licenses because, you know, Upper Deck basically screwed the pooch and bungled their chance at continuing on with you know, their various licenses. And so Panini now is in charge of basketball. And unfortunately, Jordan... Upper Deck has exclusive rights to Jordan's images and likenesses and autographs specifically. And so Panini, despite having the NBA license, is not allowed to use Jordan's likeness or picture or anything in any of the products. And so this lawsuit happened because back in, so originally in 2017, Panini, who now also owns Donruss, you know, they released their Donruss basketball set. And the first image of their insert series, the Retro Series, yeah, literally just called Retro Series. Pretty cool. You know, you got like the purple, the black, you know, kind of like throwback colors from that era.
Reminds me of Saved by the Bell.
Yeah, absolutely. No,
the Magician's Cafe. Max. No,
actually, that's like He-Man's Master of the Universe colors.
Yes, you know? But, yes.
but no, so in that Donruss Scottie Pippen card, it looks fine. You know, it's just Pippen, you know, skying through the air about to, you know, probably throw down like a little reverse layup or dunk. And so there's Donruss, and then there's Donruss Optic, kind of like the step-up product where instead of just the cards being paper, they're more of like this thicker cardstock and glossy. So it's technically a nicer product than just the Donruss, but they frequently use the same image, except Panini tried to sneak one under the radar and unphotoshopped or left in the original image where Jordan, you know, you can see like a little 3mm, you know, size Jordan in the bottom right corner. And Upper Deck took offense to that. So that was offense number one, right?
Right.
And then exhibit A, so to speak, in legal parlance, right?
Right.
And then exhibit B was the year later, they released an image of Rodman on their winning tickets insert series. And this was in 2018 Contenders. And same thing, in the right side of the image, Upper Deck contends that Panini purposely did not crop the image tighter to exclude Jordan standing in the background. I mean, they faded the background and made him look, you know, not the focus of the card, obviously, but on the right side of that card, you can very clearly see Jordan's silhouette looking at Rodman and even Bulls 23 in their white uni. And so very blatantly a Jordan image. And I would say that takes up like a solid, you know, using the 3x3 rule of, you know, nines, yeah, at least like 1/9 of that card is Jordan. So
this was, just to recap, this was massive litigation that went on and on and reached this settlement. And when I first heard this, I thought it was ridiculous. But then you see how these are virtually identical cards, and I think that Panini got caught trying to slip some Easter eggs. What do you think about all this nonsense, Joey?
I always thought it was a matter of time before the players kind of get in on their likeness and like the card and memorabilia business.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I had no idea that Jordan was with a specific company, and I don't know. It's kind of wild to keep up with. It did remind me, though, in my personal collection of Michael Jordan's, I have two cards that are Sam Vincent.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes.
And it was like the one game where Jordan didn't wear 23 or 45. It, there's a picture of him.
Yep.
And you see he's in the card wearing number 12.
Yes. And that is a sought after card.
Yeah. Awesome. Got a few of those, but that just reminded me of that. It's just kind of nonsense stuff.
Absolutely. And there's from that same set, a Mark Jackson card that you would think is not that big of a deal, but it evidently has the Menendez brothers.
Yep. That was that one.
It was like the week after they had killed their parents too.
Are you kidding me?
Yeah, it's like that day. It's like
they're just hanging out on the court, like nothing happened, smiling in the background of that card.
Yeah. Oh, that is so creepy. It is. What do you think about this, Timmy?
I mean, does it surprise me? No, right? You know, this is kind of like
so absurd.
It's absurd. It's petty, you know. Upper Deck's just kicking and screaming, throwing their little tantrum because they got left out of the cool kids side of the court, you know. So, but I can see why they're suing. I mean, there's so much money at stake, right? And the dumb thing is, this is one tiny little card. So two cards out of how many sets, how many series, how many thousands, well, tens of thousands of cards have they actually produced in that time frame?
Right.
And Upper Deck singles in on these two, right? Yeah.
Yes, yeah. And I would tend to particularly agree with you that Upper Deck is just being absurd, except for the fact that these cards are identical, virtually. Yeah, and it's so clear that Panini has so clearly busted themselves on doing it intentionally.
Yeah. Right, because they obviously were able to Photoshop out Jordan in the Donruss paper copy, but then in the Optic one, they were like, nope, we're just going to fly.
Exactly.
just pretend we forgot.
No, exactly right.
Blame it on the intern.
Joey, what do you know about NFTs? Non-fungible tokens.
I've not done any research on it. My idea is that it's like, you're buying digital art or something like that.
Yeah, kind of.
Stupid guess, though.
You know, that's exactly a correct guess about a stupid part of the hobby.
Teach it to me as if I'm a fifth grader.
Explain to Joey what Top Shot is, Tim, that you own. Tim owns some. Tim actually spent money on this.
Which I now can't get back out of NBA Top Shot because won't approve my withdrawal request. Those jerks. It's $75. And I just like locked in. But no, NBA Top Shot was, this attempt at digital immortalization.
Let's use the Jordan replay clips. The time when Jordan pushed off B Russ in the finals.
Oh, yeah. So say you had that awesome 3-little-second clip of Jordan hitting that shot after Byron conveniently fell off to the side.
After he was pushed.
And, So just that clip, that little 3-second snippet, that would be a non-fungible token of an NBA highlight or a moment that you now have the ability to buy as a moment digitally. And they're selling those. They're taking these little highlight segments from recent NBA seasons, and they've serial numbered them out of like 30,000 or like, you know, there's some nicer ones that are rarer than that, lower numbered. And yeah, they've become like a digital collectible, and people somehow found and whatever.
You know, so they cut up 3-second YouTube clips.
Yeah.
They claim there are only 30,000 of them, which how would you know? Because you can copy it as many times as you want, and then they sell them to you, rubes like Tim.
Hey!
And it's not like Tim now owns that piece of. owns the copyright for that piece of video. He just owns a YouTube clip that someone claims to be at a 30,000. Okay. So
it's NBA license, damn it. You know, like it's not like they blurred out the team names or the numbers.
And they give you like, they give you little like electronic binders to put them in. And it's so ridiculous. So, but I think it's the sad future of the hobby. It just came out that Tim Berners-Lee, you know who that is? He invented the internet.
He invented the World Wide Web, right?
The World Wide Web, that's right. He wrote the first source code, and he is giving away that source code as an NFT. And what it, you get is a video of him typing the source code in.
He's like pained right now just listening to this.
You, don't you want to own the internet?
What do you do with it? Like, what?
Nothing. But nothing.
Exactly.
You have company over
exactly.
To watch it. Like,
exactly. Like, how do you even display that? That's exactly what we were yelling at Tim about. Is like, Tim, how would you display your Top Shot? You have to download the app. Get every.
You're gonna make me share my screen on Zoom right now and play these clips for you.
Oh, please do it. Oh.
And you'll bill us for it.
You're going to be blown away, Joey. You just wait.
So you will get, let's see, creators in the auction, which begins began this yesterday, will run for 1 week. Collectors will have a chance to bid on a bundle of items, including the 10,000 lines of the source code to the original web browser, a digital poster created by Berners-Lee representing the code, a letter from him, and an animated video showing the code being entered. It's not even him entering it. It's just...
some random dude fingers.
But here's why this is a problem, and it'll take us to our next story. Panini has announced plans for a Prism NFT. Those are the Nico Mannion cards I just sent you, Joey. The Prism. And those Prism cards, and chasing that rainbow. Tim, can you quantify how important that is to the hobby? Is it not the number one most sought after collector group in basketball?
You mean product wise?
Product wise, sure.
You know,
the rainbows are just like they're. I've never seen their base cards have been able to sell at ridiculous rates.
Yeah, and that's all it is, right? It's the same exact image, just in a different color background and serial numbered stamped. You know, and so there's, you know, like out of 99, out of 199, out of 149, and so, you know, like you chase one of each of those. And so, for example, Luka Doncic, you know, I know a couple guys who have come dangerously close to finishing like the entire rainbow, like each one of those cards, and it's a ridiculous collection. And so if you do that for a player, it's a fun chase, but yeah, it takes a while.
Just so you know, the rookie card in Prism, Joey, I sold the one out of 50 for $4.
Whew.
I'll beep that. But it, like, it's not, they do not mess around with that when it comes to Luka. So what do we think? Oh, he's going to do it. He's going to do it. I'm going to pod down the music.
This is what I'm showing you right now. Sorry to interrupt this broadcast, but this is this might actually be worth something. It's Ben Simmons making a layup. He didn't even do that in the playoffs this year. That's my moment, Joey.
Oh my God.
And he owns it.
An ugly looking layup.
Along with 30,000 people and all of YouTube.
He's jumping off his wrong foot.
Yeah.
And shooting a right handed layup.
The worst form layup hook shot I've ever seen in my life.
It's versus the Celtics, Boston Steve.
Oh.
Sixers beat him.
Oh, that's painful.
Just like that. Yeah. There you go.
I think I'm gonna bill you for that moment.
But right, they are releasing these through. They're releasing green packs and red packs. What do we think about these? I think that this could spell a lot of trouble. I think that people are going to seek these NFTs out. I will not be one of them, but I think they're going to be very popular. Timmy, are you going to buy some? Did you mute yourself again?
No. I did that on purpose while I was looking. No, but not a chance that I'm buying one of these. I learned my lesson. Fool me once, you know, shame on me.
Joey, they're only 10 or 20 bucks.
Yeah, don't do it. Just nope.com.
I ain't buying shit.
All right. And finally, Timmy, why don't you bring us home with this last story? Because you were the one to find it.
So, thinking back to those slabs that you were holding earlier, Joey, HGA, they're a new kid on the block, but one of the less new kids on the block, of which there's now, like, you know, all these other companies trying to get in on this market share of grading. But so thinking back to your collection, you know, most cards are vertical, right? But, you know, there are definitely cards in your collection that are probably where the image is horizontally oriented, right? So when you put one of those horizontally oriented cards into one of these slabs, they have to decide to flip it one way or another. And so, you know, obviously you can't display it as it's actually meant to be looked at. And so HGA came up with a slab that is more square than, you know, rectangular. And they are the first, as far as I know, to have a slab that, you know, you actually can display the card horizontally, but it looks like a big giant square monstrosity. So instead of like the nice little, you know, rectangular slab that you've been holding, that's their idea. So to be released soon. And people just generally kind of laugh about it. But, you know, I just wanted to know what your thoughts are, because seems like it's, I mean, you could go both ways, right? It could be cool. Yeah.
Picking up Ricky's stack of cases, mm-hmm. I think having one that just completely stands out like that one would be, I mean, I have no problem turning the cart sideways myself.
Right.
I get their idea and their logic, but I don't know.
If you're going to do it, I agree with you, Joey. I don't think you can do it. And I think if you're going to, it has to somehow maintain the same shape as the vertical mm-hmm. cards.
Yeah, they didn't mark up the dimensions, but they made no indication that like the height of the horizontal slab is going to match up with the height of the vertical ones. And so you're going to have like these odd shaped square ones. It would drive you nuts, Ricky. And then on top of that, you know, the cases that we store our cards in, like there's no storage box or storage bin right now that can slot a double wide card horizontally. Like it just, and then what, you know, you become a horizontal card collector only for display purposes. Yeah. Hey, what do you PC, bro? I PC horizontal cards.
Oh, that's funny. That's really funny. Oh man. Yeah. No, I do agree with you, the both of you. What do you PC, brah? Horizontal, brah. Hey, yeah. For horizontal cards, though, if you are turning them, or if they're going to be in a normal slab, which way should a horizontal card face? There is a correct answer. I'd like to hear it from both of you. Left or right?
Turn it to the right. I don't know. Yeah.
So the bottom of the card should be on the right side of the card, so that you tilt it left down to the right. You turn it clockwise.
Turn it clockwise to get it oriented.
If you're right-handed, you would turn it to the left. So the left side would be the bottom.
Oh, no. Damn, yeah. You're the tiebreaker.
No, so the bottom of the horizontal card would be on the right side of the card when it's standing oriented. Yeah, standing vertically. Yep. And then the slip of the graded card should be on the top.
That's OCD for you, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah. Tim and Ricky.
You guys are wrong.
All right. Well, when we come back, I'm really excited to get Joey's response to Tim is cutting cards and we're doing a big pack war. We'll be back after this.
Hi, this is Dr. Sadim giving you an insider look into my new group submission service, where I guarantee your card will get a PSA 5 or better when PSA finally resumes their economy service level for $100 a card.
Welcome. You've got mail.
It's just that easy. Call 801-893-1609 to find out more.
All right, everyone, welcome back to the show. You can check us out on our Twitter at PTTFpod. You can check us out on YouTube, Pack to the Future Podcast. or anywhere that iTunes or that, excuse me, anywhere that podcasts are found. Timmy, you sent me a troubling photo the other day.
Yeah.
you sent in a PSA sub, looked to be mostly Jordans, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, it was a random little 5-card lot of Jordan cards that I picked up at some point last year.
And how'd you do? Any fives? Any fives?
Yeah, progress. No fives. And no sixes.
No.
And no sevens.
Hey, you know, in my mind, those are all quality cards. That's a win.
That's a win.
Right? But 5 for 5?
PSA. No, not quite 5 for 5. Well, 5 for 5 in terms of no fives or sixes. I'm pulling up this picture again, but
yeah, and I'll
know how PSA thinks I got to no fives or sixes though.
How?
Said one of the cards is coming back as possibly trimmed or altered.
I don't believe that's what it says. I believe it says evidence of cutting.
Yeah, it was stronger language than that, huh?
Which concerns me greatly because we did not cover it with my cousin Joey, who had to run. We thank him very much for joining us in those first two segments. I had sent him one of my Jordan cards that came back, and it said simply it did not meet the minimum size requirement. Effectively, I was a victim, if you will. You seem to be being treated as the perpetrator.
Oh, shoot. This was ridiculous, Ricky. Just to make it clear, I do not trim my cards. That's definitely taking a one step way too far as prepping for a sub. And well, we know that.
Well, and when we had, before you were on the podcast, we had Dr. Shine on. And you actually reached out to Chad and I pretty quickly on, and you were pretty livid. You were saying, that's not a cool thing to do. That's not, I don't support it. You weren't very happy for us even having him on. So it's a big deal. And I don't know how they would come up with this idea that there's evidence of cutting versus minimum size requirements.
Yeah, I mean, it makes you wonder, right? Like, I mean, obviously they're looking under these, you know, supposedly they're looking under magnification, right? And they've got their techniques and their tools, and some of which are proprietary and unbeknownst to us. But, I mean, you know that Chad and I look at these cards pretty darn closely. And, you know, you've seen me look over the cards in your binder.
Yes.
You know, I bought some of these Jordan cards off of somebody who literally was just keeping these cards in a binder. So I have no reason to believe that this was somebody who, like, was actively trying to doctor cards and, like, pawn them off as higher quality than they were. Like, he couldn't have given a crap, right? Like,
right.
These are cards literally pulled out of a box, basically. And PSA is saying, oh, nope, evidence of being trimmed or altered.
Yeah.
What? Yeah. You know, I'm not sitting there dicking around with an X-Acto knife, you know, like accidentally leaving a stray mark on the card. It's like, oh, oops. Yeah. Sorry, PSA. You know, like, let's see if I can sneak this one past you. I mean,
you know, like, and it's interesting that you say that, because with my card that didn't meet the minimum size requirements, it was a card from my youth that was in my binder. And I almost wonder if sitting in those binders for 20 years, like, compresses them to a point
that
they are just too small. I don't know. And they need to come out with a tool. There's all those tools on eBay, right, that we have that tells about centering cards. We need a tool now to tell us if it's a large enough card.
Yeah, I mean, there's that, right? Like, I mean, but how would you design it, right? Because if it was, like, perfectly sized to be a regulation size card, like, you would ding the edges trying to put in a correctly sized card, right?
That's true. Like, it's got to be some sort of, like, light scanner, I think, that, like, turns green if it's all covered, or red if it's not.
Yeah, that's true. I'm sure there's an app for that, right? Like, that could correctly measure a card.
I'm visualizing, like, the TSA line. You put your license down and it says it lights up green, and I think it might light up red, and, like, I'm always terrified it's gonna turn red. Exactly. Well, that is really unfortunate. But otherwise, I think you did pretty good with your cards, and that'll be kind of fun to have those back.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, one of them was that championship Jordan, the metal championship one with the John Hancock Tower in the background, and I was really hoping for another raw one to come back at least a 9, but got screwed again. Got an 8.
Oh, eights are good.
Eights are good. Yeah, I'm telling you, those would have been 9s last year. I feel pretty strongly about that, but yeah. It is what it is. You know.
This past week, Chad, and I went to the card shop. The local card shop.
We did. And we actually went together this time. We
we were brought together after the Jazz lost. I'm surprised that the three of us ended up there actually the day after.
I think that was Chad. To be fair, we were kind of there on behalf of Chad to make sure he didn't, walk into the train tracks or something.
So. Right. But it was a fun trip. Good to see the two of you. As you mentioned, the three of us all went there together. And while we were there, we came up with some pretty good ideas, I felt. We were kind of spitballing it regarding the show and threw out some ideas that you may want to check out in the future, which includes recording from the local card shop once a month, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty exciting. Our local card shop, we will be recording from the local card shop. We talked with the owner, so that was awesome.
Yeah, I think that'll be a lot of fun. That's been a long time coming, and then obviously COVID kind of put a damper on some of that for a while. But that'll just be like super cool energy. Hearing the hustle and bustle in the background, people talking shop, the little jingle on the door as it opens and closes.
Right.
And
we're going to have Tanner on early on.
We need to. Yes.
He has so many interesting stories.
Bust him out of his show.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But none of that will be the first thing we do when we record live from the show.
Oh, no.
Because
you've got something in mind. Yep. Yeah.
You and Chad, the gauntlet was thrown down, and you and Chad made a purchase. Why don't you tell us about it?
We got kind of fired up about the incorrect French-Italian debacle on a Court King's insert, and there happened to be two boxes of Court King's from 2020-2021 Panini Court King's this year. And lo and behold, it was exactly two boxes for just...
And what happened?
Both of us, Chad and us.
Chad throws out the gauntlet, and not 30 seconds later, you guys are still trying to decide, and someone almost buys at least one of them.
Yeah, I know. And then I was like, nope, okay, we're doing it.
So, yep.
Because one of those rules at a local card shop is to not leave the last boxes on the shelf because there's something good in it.
Well, because we watched before Chad hit his first one of one, he was looking at a box of baseball, turned to me and said, yeah, I think I am going to get it, but I'm going to see what else there is. In the meantime, someone picked it up, opened it in store, and it was a one of one.
Yep. That was pre him pulling an actual one of one for himself. So,
so $250 per box.
Fantastic price, which was like another reason, we just had to do it.
So. Yeah. $250 for what? 8 cards, 6 cards,
mm-hmm.
2 cards. A patch, an auto, and probably a few base cards is my guess.
Well, yeah, if we're lucky. If Panini counted right.
So it wasn't that you guys were just going to... Because I would not be holding these two sealed boxes of Court Kings. Priced at $250 per box, per pack, if you will. I wouldn't be holding them here today. Why am I holding them instead of you guys having ripped them and in your collection?
One, because no wax stays unopened within 10 feet of my reach. So, but two, because it's going down, baby. It's going to be a box war.
Oh, box war. Okay. So Chad found box wars online. And what it is they were doing them, I think, at Nationals. And people would buy two of the same box and whoever, after they opened their boxes, whoever had the most valuable card, as determined by comps, I assume, the highest comp.
Uh-huh. Yeah, comps, estimated value, whatever you want to do there.
Okay,
yeah.
So we're going to have to sort this out. Gets to keep both boxes.
Both boxes, yeah, in this case. I mean, there's also Pack Wars, you know, where, like, the lowest serial numbered card wins, you know, all the cards in that box if you're just fighting over packs. I mean, there's a lot of different formats for this, but we're going whole box, baby. So yeah. Winner take all. Best card wins.
Box war.
And you know Chad's not pulling it. I'm just putting it out there, right, Ricky? Like, Chad's not pulling a better card than I am. Like, there's no chance in hell.
Well, I'm not one to predict much success for Chad in pulling big hits. However, he is facing the human rain cloud in Timmy.
This is true. I'm like a walking curse right now. So.
Be sure to check out our social media. You will not want to miss this when we do it. We'll find a way to put the video up on our YouTube. We will be doing it live at our local card shop, Overtime Cards. Maybe if you really ask nicely, Timmy will give you the invite to let you join by Zoom and watch the Power
That
Wars.
Would be fun. It's going down, baby.
All right. Well, for Tim and guest host Joey, I'm Ricky, the Box War, wishing all of you a one of one night. So, Timmy.
Yep.
You were talking about a mistake in selling a previous Donovan Mitchell RPA.
Yeah, I don't want to think about it.
From National Treasures. I know. And I want to let you know that we can talk about it next week. I think that National Treasures and Flawless have a massive issue with their cards, particularly their RPAs. That should make them way less valuable than they are.
I want to hear this.